She's a senior lecturer in digital learning at Glasgow Caledonian University. She's a big blogger, and you can see she's very, very active on social media, and there's an About Me page where you'll find everything about her. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to be here at EUNIS with you all today. So I just want to say thank you to the committee for asking me and to Jill for suggesting me. As Martin's talk there at the end, I think it got all a bit dystopian, didn't it? But I think we're living in interesting times, I think, as we would say. I know personally, I have felt over the last year that I'm living through history in a way that I have never experienced before. And yes, it's quite a momentous day in the UK today, as many of you will know. And depending on what happens tomorrow morning, I might just stay here. you never know. I want to stay in Europe. But that's another story for another day. So when Jill approached me to do the talk today, she gave me quite a big brief. She said, I'd like to talk about open education. I said, well, that's great. But it's quite a big topic to cover in, what, 45 minutes? So there's many elements to open them, and in many ways it's like a story, and that's why I chose the title for this talk, The Never-Ending Story, because there's lots of different aspects to open at a global, at a national, and at a personal level. And I don't really know how it's going to end, what's going to happen, which is quite exciting. And I have to apologise here if any of you are of an age that you remember the movie The Never-Ending Story in the 1980s. If you now have the theme tune running into your head, sorry about that, I won't sing it, but but what I want to do in the short time that I have today is kind of introduce you to some of the main characters of openness and some of the narratives around it. So what is open? Well, it's very complicated, but I think sometimes we all feel a bit like Bastion, the hero of the story. You know, we go into this fantastic new world, we might find our equivalent of Eritrea, our heroes that we follow as they engage in different aspects of the story. But, you know, I think the thing for me about open education is that it's quite a personal thing, and as we change and become open, it's very much a personal decision. But this year, 2017, is quite a significant year for openness, as it's been declared the Year of Open by the Open Education Consortium. It's been 15 years since the Budapest Open Access Initiative, 10 years since the Cape Town Open Education Declaration, and 5 years since the Paris OER Declaration. So what's actually happened in this century? What's happened? How has open licenses, open data, open research, open education, how has it permeated into our society and into our education system? I'm going to hopefully take you through a few elements of that today. But before we do that, a little bit of interactivity. As I've alluded to, open is quite complicated, so I just wanted to get an idea of what open means to you. So if you have an internet-enabled device, which I'm presuming that many of you do, if you could go to that address and vote, if you could put the first word, or I'm going to give you up to three words, first words that come into your mind when someone says open to you, and I'll just put up the results of that as well. So if you can just do that, you should get that line. Hopefully this will work. Oh, great. Free. Good one. Oh, nice. Later. finished, I will put this in my slides and I'll share this with you as well. But that's lovely. Okay, so lots of things coming out. Lots and lots of things coming out there. Okay, we'll come back to that. Thank you very much for that. So I think that kind of very quickly through that word cloud, you can see that it, as Facebook used to say, it's quite complicated, isn't it? So I think, you know, sometimes to help us do these complexities, some definitions do help. And the Open Education Consortium, they define open education, I quite like this, they say open education encompasses resources, tools and practices that employ a framework of open sharing to improve educational access and effectiveness worldwide. So that's a really nice kind of global aim that I think most people would find hard to say anything negative about that. But it is still quite, I thought that was going to come up there, I just seen a Twitch notification come up here, but it hasn't come up on the screen, that's good. But it is complicated. This phrase, a mouthful of open pins, and this is just a little diagram that I did. If you have got the patience to go to that link, I've made a little interactive version of this. I was at an event last month at the University of the Highlands and Islands in Inverness, and it was called the Porous University. And we were talking about different aspects of openness and maybe taking quite critical reflection on where we are just now. And we had a virtually connecting session as part of that. I don't know if any of you have heard of virtually connecting, but it's a community-based web conferencing community that goes around different conferences, and it kind of just extends conference participation a little bit more. And one of the delegates there at our UC Connecting session, she said, I feel with open I have a mouthful of open pins because I don't know where to start. There are so many different aspects of openness. And I thought that was quite a nice expression, and it really summed up some of the issues and some of the challenges. If you're not an open educator and you're trying to think about open, about getting to grips with open. So there are many layers of open. I often think it's quite like a Russian doll. I think that's quite a nice analogy for openness, because there's many different layers to open. And sometimes more layers are on display than others, and sometimes lots of things are hidden away as well. But it is quite complicated. So maybe if we think about the history of open education, that can help us to get to think about how did we get to where we are just now in 2017. I really like this little visualization from Julius Versailles. I think it encompasses quite a lot of the things that about opening education. I think it's quite easy to think of open education of something of our time as very much a 21st century phenomenon. But actually, you know, because there have been many significant initiatives and you know, movements that have started and you know have come to prominence in this century. But obviously, the history of open education goes back much, much further than you know 2002. In some ways, you should probably argue that the history of open education started with the history of education because it's fundamentally about sharing and extending knowledge. And again, just to go back to definitions, I think Martin Weller from the Open University in the UK, he summed it up quite nicely, kind of the history of open education in this great sentence. You know, its foundations lie in altruism, and I think that's very, very true. You know, people believe that education is for a public good. And I would say that most European universities have that notion of civic responsibility and at the core of what they do, at their foundation. So that ties in very, very well with kind of our notions of a modern university and modern open education, if you like. So what I want to do now is just like introduce you to some of the kind of the characters, if you like, around about open education in our open education story. And as many of you are dealing with infrastructure, I thought that would be quite a good place to start. And look quickly at open source, open data, and open standards. So I think undoubtedly the growth of open source software has really impacted and influenced the growth of open education and open in general. You know, it's been great to see that, the growth of that. But what open source software has done as well, I think it raised one of the key challenges about open, and one of the words that I did notice that came up in the word cloud there was free. Now, open doesn't mean free, and that's quite a challenge for lots of people. So there's a cost to all aspects of open. So whilst you might be able to access open source software, to actually use it and implement it effectively, that takes resources, and they're genuine human resources. So, you know, there is a balance that always has to be struck by when you're using or thinking about using any kind of anything with open. You have to be able to resource that properly. In our keynote at OER, the OER 16 conference in Edinburgh last year, Melissa Highton, who's the head of Learning and Web Services at the University of Edinburgh, she talked about technical debt quite a lot and the cost of technical debt. And it really resonated with me because she explained technical debt as the cost of implementing a system and not implementing a system effectively. So maybe trying, and I think in universities we're quite guilty of doing that. We quite often buy systems because somebody thinks that it's going to solve a problem, but then we don't resource it properly, so it actually doesn't, and in many cases it just exacerbates the problem. So I think we have to be wary of the cost of technical debt. And if we are going to implement open source software, that we really think about the resources that it will really need to make a difference in our institution. So we have to be wary of that. So I think, you know, open source software has tremendous benefits, not just for education, but, you know, for our whole society. But only if it's implemented and resourced properly, and only if those developments are shared back into the community as well. So if we think about open data, I mean, Martin's already shared some really quite entertaining, slightly scary in some ways, examples of how we can use AI and data. But I think, you know, in terms of open data, there's been quite a really positive move, I think, in this century around opening data. And there's been a lot of government buy-in to, you know, to at least make publicly funded research and data openly available. You know, if we pay for something, if the public body pay for something, why shouldn't we be able to access it? And I think, you know, things like Martin's self-driving cars, and that's a great example, but smart cities, they're a really good example of open data. And when you get data from local authorities, from health boards, from civic communities, from education, from transport systems, and you integrate them together and allow the community to start building things with that data, it's really exciting. Where I live in Glasgow, we've had a smart city initiative, and it's been really, really exciting to see the kind of a community engagement that has fostered. And that's really exciting, so that's a good thing to see. But the other thing we need to think about in data is sort of a flip side to that just now, and I think that was kind of an undercurrent maybe in Martin's talk as well, is that data is power, and we are all giving away more data to various companies, to institutions, to governments than we've ever done before. Learning analytics is a very good example of that. But we need to be sure that we are being open about what we're doing and that we're being ethical about what we're doing, and students and staff know where their data is being collected, how it's being collected, and why it's being used and how it's being used. And we should always have an option to opt out of that as well. There's some very serious discussions that need to be had about who owns data and who can access educational data. Is it the student? Is it the staff member? Is it the institution? Or is it the vendor? Because ultimately, if the vendor don't give us access to our data, then we can't really do very much with it. We can only do what they will allow us to do. So we have to look at that. Again, that's another story for another time. Now, I know Rob is maybe going to mention open standards in his talk later, so I'm not going to talk too much about that. I have spent quite a lot of my working life working around supporting open standards, done a lot of work with IUNIS, and I work with a support centre called CETUS in the UK. Open standards are a key part of our infrastructure in universities. And I have to say, I'm continually amazed just now in 2017 at the things that I can just do that maybe 5-10 years ago was really, really complicated. You know, sharing stuff wasn't that easy. And it's so much easier this now. And interoperability and open standards, they're really key for us as a sector and as a society. And again, we have to ensure that they are truly open and that they're not proprietary. proprietary, but I'm sure Rob's going to give you more about that later. I did want to move on to another character in our story. Martin already talked about open research, and I would highly recommend going and having a look at that just publication that he mentioned. And obviously open research is at the heart of all universities. Research is a big part of our work. But I'm not going to spend too much time on this. But you know, being able to share our research openly is just becoming more and more accepted at university life. It's a given in modern university life. And there's been great strides since the Budapest Open Access Initiative. But again, I think we have this tension in terms of open and free, because there's quite a difference between Green and Gold Act open access and research publications. Again, I'm not going to talk too much about that. I just want to say, on the positive side, in terms of open data, there is a lot of research going on about open educational practice just now and open educational resources. So we have a growing amount of research and open data about open education. So projects like the OER Research Hub in the UK, they have lots and lots of data. Just now we have a wonderful world map of OER resources. I tweeted out the links to my slides, so there's URLs for the places that I'm mentioning in the slides as well. So that's really exciting to see that evidence coming through and being shared. There are more and more PhDs now looking at open education and sharing their research back into the community. And that's really important for us in universities. We need that research base. We need to have the evidence that open education is having an impact so that we can make the arguments to have the resources to do that, so we can make those cost and economic arguments. Of course, can't talk about openness without talking about this guy here, open educational resources. And I think they are very much a kind of a notion of the 21st century. Advances in technology, interoperability, but probably most importantly, licenses have allowed us to share things and to, you know, use David Wiley's 5 R's of retain, reuse, revive, remix, and redistribute. You know, we can do that so much more easily now. So they are really, you know, there's a lot of work about OERs, and I think we're actually seeing some clear evidence now that OERs are having an impact on education. Particularly open textbooks, and there's lots of evidence coming out of North America where I think textbooks have a slightly different place in the curriculum, well, certainly than most UK university courses. I'm not saying that we don't use books, we just don't use them in the same way. There's lots of evidence coming out now about cost savings and a real economic model that is coming through, which is really, really positive. And again, that's been shared openly. So that is really important. I'm going to talk about policy for a bit. I know Martin's mentioned that. I think open policy is incredibly important for our open story and for our open infrastructure. And there's a huge amount of work going on across Europe around open policy. In fact, only last week there was a conference in Poland for the Open Policy Network. And this month, the theme of the Open Education Week is actually open policy. So there's lots of, actually there's some really interesting videos on their website with some global perspectives on policy. But policy is important on many levels. It's a signifier of intent, which is very, very important for us. It gives you recognition and it helps build momentum for a movement. So I just want to quickly go a bit low-tech now. A quick show of hands. How many of you in your institutions have an OER policy or any kind of open educational policy? Anyone? Nobody? Wow. Go back to your institutions and try and start getting one. We have an open education policy in my institution, and it's been really useful in a number of ways, particularly for someone like me. I work in an academic development so I am trying to get my colleagues to use open education resources, to reshare them, and to be a bit more open in their practice. The fact that we have got support, and our OER policy was driven through mainly by the hard work of colleagues in the library, but we have lots of support and guidance on licensing, on sharing, which is really useful, but it also gives a lot of confidence to staff in terms of engaging with openness, because we've made that institutional statement of intent through policy. So it's very important to have policy. At a national level in Scotland, I've been involved in a movement called Open Scotland for about 4 or 5 years ago. This is very much a grassroots movement. We got together and a number of people, and this is actually now being led and driven by my friend and former colleague Lorna Campbell. And we developed this thing called the Open Scotland Declaration, which was very much based on the Paris Open Education Declaration. And we've tried to get institutions, individuals and governments to sign up to that. Again, because we've been working in the open, a lot of countries in mainland Europe have looked at that, and it's been really satisfying to see that, how we've been able to have some conversations at that level. We still haven't had very much success getting the Scottish government, unfortunately, to sign up to that, but we'll keep fighting the good fight. But policy is important, so I would encourage you to go back to your institutions and have a think about having an OER policy and see if you can get one. But whilst resources and policies are all part of the open education experience, there is more. So let's have a look at another one. Open online learning, which again we've had some allusion to this morning from Martin's talk. So open online learning, I mean, that comes out of the history of distance learning, which then moved on online, and you know, institutions like the Open University in the UK and beyond. There are lots of universities had an element of online learning for quite a while. Before the MOOCs came along, and remember, you know, back in 2012, remember the MOOCs? Remember when they were going to change everything for us? Remember when there was only going to be 12 universities left in the world? I think we can say that, you know, some of the, you know, the disruption klaxons that were sounding very, very loudly when MOOCs came on the scene have kind of rescinded somewhat, and I think MOOCs have been, they've evolved into something that's really quite interesting, but they've been kind of embraced into university practice in a way that possibly wasn't expected, or certainly wasn't mentioned in some of the mainly Silicon Valley narratives that were coming out about MOOCs when they were really big back in 2012. But again, I think this goes back to that open and free conundrum. How can you actually make any money out of MOOCs, out of open online courses, if you're not charging for them? You know, that the, there were different levels of most MOOC, of openness for most MOOCs anyway, and there still are. So I think it's interesting, and definitely open online learning does have a role to play in our wider educational landscape. But they're being integrated in different ways, which I think is really exciting for people. And they are having an impact on institutional practice. They are a way of engaging with a wider audience. You don't necessarily need to engage with 30,000 people, but actually just opening up bits of your educational experiences and bits of your programmes can actually help you in bringing in people to your, you know, postgraduate or undergraduate degrees as well. So it's a constantly evolving area, but you know, there was open online learning before the MOOCs, and there will be open online learning after them as well. But what I really want to talk about today is open educational practice, because this is kind of the big character, I think. This is what makes open real. I am a self-declared open educational practitioner. That's how I describe myself just now. And you probably noticed, I think word cloud someone had open sesame. I was thinking this makes like me to think of Sesame Street, because it's kind of brought to you by the letter P. So there's lots of P's around practice. There's pedagogy, privacy, privilege, praxis, porosity, you know, pragmatism, which I don't think I've got there. They're just some of the words that you have to deal with and some of the concepts that you have to deal with when you're thinking about integrating open education in any of it, or openness in any aspect, into your own practice. Catherine Cronin has written a paper, again there's a link to it in the slides, and she describes open educational practice this way, and I think this is just a lovely phrase: it's complex, personal, contextual and continuously negotiated. And I think that's a really key point, this continuous negotiation. You know, I know that every day I have to make a multitude of decisions about how open I am going to be, how I'm going to be open, where I'm going to be open, if I'm going to be open. You know, so that could be searching for an open educational resource to use. It could be deciding to share something openly via our institutional open educational resource repository. It could be that I'm using bits of openness in closed situations. You know, when I'm teaching like this in a lecture theatre, I might be using open educational resources. This is quite a closed environment. Our virtual learning environment, similarly, you know, it's quite closed, but I might be harnessing lots of different aspects of open. So the diagram, again from Catherine, I think this encapsulates a number of the things you have to think about as an open educational practitioner. You have to think about social learning because you are putting yourself out there. You are trying to work with wider communities and foster that notion of community. You have to balance privacy and openness. You have to think about your digital literacies because being an open practitioner and being able to find, share, use, and discuss open draws on a core set of digital capabilities and digital literacies. And it does kind of challenge some of our traditional teaching roles. So there's a lot to think about there, and it is continuously negotiated. But one of the things I think about being open is the sense of community. And I think one of the reasons that I continue to call myself an open practitioner is largely due to the support and the opportunity that I've had through the open community that I engage with. It is scary to put yourself out there, if you like, online, particularly in an online learning situation. And I think going back to MOOCs, I mean, I might kind of be slightly cynical of them. It's easy for me to do that, standing here talking to you here in my relative position of power for this half hour this morning. But I did sign up for a load of MOOCs. In fact, I probably was a bit of a MOOCaholic at one point. I'm on the programme now, it's okay. But I learned quite a lot about being a student again. I relearned about being a student, so it did have quite an impact on me. But you know, putting yourself out there in an open community with people that you might not know, or even people that you do know, it can be quite scary. But I have been rewarded. I've had so many opportunities come my way through that, that it's for me, it's been definitely worth the risk. But there is a flip side to that. You know, I'm quite happy. I live in a very privileged, happy, shiny, open educational bubble. But it's not always like that. And there is a flip side, of course. And I'm very well aware, as I'm sure we all are, of you know the adverse effects of interacting openly, of trolling. And I'm very lucky. I've only had a few incidents of that, relatively minor. But it's been brought home to me in the last couple of weeks because a number of people that I do know have been quite almost randomly targeted to and subjected to some pretty horrible online abuse. But one of the things they have spoken about through that is the support that they've got from their open communities because they have that back channel of people globally that they can connect to. And so there have been lots of us that have been blocking significant amounts of Twitter comments there. But again, it goes back to that balance that you have to think about. This is the image here, something I did for the OER 17 conference in April in London. We were talking about open community. Are you familiar with the idea of desire trails or elephant paths? Yeah? You know, it's that if you have, it's actually quite a good analogy on university campuses. You know, sometimes we have buildings and we will build a path, but then you find people will take a shortcut like that and you get these sort of little paths that appear over time. Sometimes they're called desire paths because that's the way that people desire to get to places. Whatever I'm doing, my desire paths, it seems recently, are always bringing me back to my open community. So I think that's a real strength of openness as well. It gives us that notion of open sharing and open hospitality. Which is really, really important for any kind of successful educational experience. Another open community community I want to talk about just briefly is ALT, the Association for Learning Technology in the UK. I'm currently the vice chair of this, and I just noticed this morning that I've cut a couple of, I've lost a P, it must have got a little lost on the other slide. So that's not participation, that should be participation, and it's not collaboration, it's collaboration. I think you can probably work that out. But we just launched, ALT is a member organisation in the UK, and we support the effective use of learning technology. And we recently launched our new 3-year strategy, and these are our 4 principles, and openness is at the heart of what we do. And I am really, really proud, as I know the rest of the trustees are, that we have been able to be so open about supporting openness. We have found the balance. We share a lot back with the community, we open up our events as much as we can. But we are a membership organisation, we do rely on subscription and commercial opportunities, particularly our conference. But our community is actually growing, it's getting stronger just now. And I think that is due in no small part to the fact that we are open and we share our resources openly. So that's given us a real strength, and that we have that model now that we can be a membership organisation and we can be an open community. Of course we still have some closed spaces, but we're trying to be as open as we possibly can. So again, another example of an open community and how you can have a balance between openness and, you know, some of the costs that open brings as well. Now, it's tempting to think of openness as a tremendous gift, and in fact, hey, you can gift openness, and maybe in some ways it's the gift that keeps giving. But in an increasingly global world, I think you have to be very careful and very cautious about any kind of gift. During keynote at this year's OER17 conference in London, Mahabali from the American University in Cairo, she gave a very interesting talk called Hiding in the Open, and she talked quite a lot about, I suppose, those of us in the global north, if you'd like, or in Western Europe and America, about our notions of gifting, particularly around technology and education. And do we really actually think enough about what we're gifting to different countries? Is it actually what they need? And she had a lovely analogy, which I'm going to share with you now. She said, what use is an apple to a hungry person who doesn't have any teeth? And I think you have to think about that. So, you know, what use is, you know, OER to people if you don't have stable internet access? What use is a device if you can't afford to pay for the data to do anything with that device? When we're thinking about open, I know I've talked a lot about the letter P, but when we're talking about open, does the E stand for English? And it's something I'm always aware of when I come to mainland Europe and when I come to conferences, international conferences like this. And I can stand up here and talk in my native tongue, and you can all understand me. And in fact, you all probably have better grammar than what I do. So we have to think about that and when we're gifting, what we're gifting. So I think we need to allow the opening agenda to be adapted, to be revised, to be used all the 5 R's that David Wiley has. It has to be done by all the global communities, and it has to work in the context that people need it to work. And it needs to be embrace diversity, and that needs to be constantly negotiated as well. So we can never think that we know what we need to give other people. That has to be a dialogue, and we have to foster that dialogue all the time. So I'm drawing to a close now, but I just want to think about some of the never-ending issues that we have to deal with. Sustainability, obviously for anything that we want to do in education or anywhere, is key. We need to think very carefully about what kind of models we are going to invest in, what is sustainable. It might be a mixed economy, if you like, that we're having, but we need to think about that at institutional and personal levels. And that obviously brings on to that, this notion of balance, you know, in constant negotiation. We need to be able to balance the cost of open access, open data, open source, OERs, open practice. But you know, making communities both are really, really important in helping do that. And if you are going to commit to open, I think you have to think of it in this way. We have a phrase in the UK and say, you know, that a puppy is not just for Christmas, you know, it's for life. I think having a commitment to any kind of openness shouldn't just be for Christmas or for 3 years. It really should be for life. It should be something that you're going to sustain and you're going to make a commitment to. The next thing I think we need to think about is open washing. Are many of you familiar with the concept of greenwashing from the green movement? Well, greenwashing, I'm just going to give you a definition of it. It's the practice of making an unsubstantiated claim or misleading claim about the environmental, or we'll say open, benefits of a product, service, technology or company practice. Open washing or greenwashing can make a company appear to be more environmentally or openly friendly than it really is. And I think we have to be very wary of that in education. I think we need to be wary of platforms and products that are telling us that they're open and they're going to do all this, allow us to do all this open stuff that we might want to do, and they'll enable it for us to do that, but they might not be. So that goes back to open standards and interoperability and non-proprietary options. So we need to make sure that we are developing our staff and our students and indeed our institutional digital capabilities so that we are all making the right decisions, or we're informed enough about products and services that we can make the right decisions, and we're not getting ourselves involved in systems that actually say they're going to do one thing but actually don't let us do another thing when it comes down to it. Again, back to that notion of technical debt. Safety is obviously something I've talked about as well. We do need to be really careful. Although there are amazing opportunities that we can offer our staff and students in terms of open education, we have a duty of care to provide safe spaces as well in education. And I think we have to remember the internet itself, although there are terrible things that happen on it, it's just a reflection of us, of our physical society. So it's not the internet that is particularly bad, it's us as people. So again, we need to think about digital literacies and making sure that our education system is actually producing people who understand how to interact appropriately online. And we need to do that. And we need to make sure that they have the competencies to do that, so that we have the open spaces that are safe for people to use. And you know, again, going back to that balance, we obviously need to have some closed spaces in education as well. I think that's very important. But we want to have spaces that then we can help people be more confident and help them on their journey to more openness as well. So I'm going to do a Martin. I'm going to go all dystopian now. But I want to talk about the nothing. If you're familiar with the never-ending story, you realise that was a big narrative part of it. There was the nothing was coming and eating everything in Fantasia and destroying the land. And I think now we're living in a time of the nothing. There are lots, and it's coming from all different angles and from different sectors of society and globally. Things are being eaten up. Things that we thought were normal are being flipped on their head. In this age of post-truth, of alternative facts, our role in universities and education is being questioned as never before. Who needs experts? What do they know? That's the nothing coming to get us. And we have to fight back against that. We have to educate people against that. You know, just now, we're obviously living in terrible times, and obviously there's been some serious things that happened in the UK in the last month in terms of terrorism. But we have to be wary of that, because then we have this threat of closing things down. So there's arguments about censorship or our threat to freedom of speech, and we have to rally against that. So whilst I'm here saying, we need to open communities up, people want want to close them down, and they may be wanting to close them down for what seem like quite good reasons, but actually they're threatening our democracy, everything that we in education hold dear. So we have to rally against that, because that's the nothing coming up to get us. And how do we have a neutral arbiter of what happens on the internet? I mean, you look at something like Twitter. What is the right way to use Twitter when you have some people, some very senior people in very senior positions in the world, who use Twitter in a way that I certainly don't think is maybe always appropriate for someone of that position? But I can't say that. We can't just shut down Twitter because of that. So we need to think about that. Because if we don't, then I think we are going to have a really dystopian future. We are going to have a future where the powerful narratives come through, the people that have the money, the millionaires that are thinking about going to Mars, who can easily say, oh, it's all right, as the gentleman pointed out earlier on, we'll just retrain people. I don't think that's good enough. We in education, we need to be making stories. We need to be telling different stories and making sure that our stories about the power of our education can fight back against the nothing, against these narratives. And it's up to us to do that. And Open can be our beacon in allowing us to do that and to share it with the rest of the world. So just to finish off, that could be another story for another time. But I want to thank you today for letting me share a bit of openness, and I look forward to sharing many more of your open stories throughout the day.